Hi, this is Marcus. I want to do a very quick tutorial to show you how I process photos by Fuji inside of Capture One. One of the things that I do inside of Capture One is that I will shoot in both JPEG and RAW. And let me explain to you why I do that. I always give Fuji the credit for being the one camera company that has really saved JPEG shooting, because if you notice, iPhone and a lot of the other mobile devices are going to a new format to try to replace JPEG. I give them a lot of credit for, you know, revitalizing, that's the word that I should use, JPEG shooting, because I haven't shot in JPEG in years. I've been shooting in RAW for about 8 years. And when I purchased these Fuji cameras, I immediately wanted to shoot in JPEG to test out the simulations. So look at the Kelvin of this is 5,000, no tint. And if we go to the RAW file, it's 6918, 3.2 tint. That's a lot more information. It's a much warmer photo. But if I wanted to kind of brighten up these dark areas here, let me show you how quickly this file breaks up when you do that. So if I go into here and I decide to say, let's pull the shadows up. I'm pulling the shadows up, but as I go into this, because it's already been processed, it's very noisy because the film simulation had grain already added into that file. So now it looks much more noisier and it's not pulling up as good as I want to. Let's raise up the blacks and see what it does. Is visibly looking like the file is coming apart, right? Because again, that information is not there. Now, let me just go to the RAW file and show you. If I decide to pull up the shadows, you can see that's much cleaner when I do that, right? And then of course, let's pull up the blacks. If I pull that up, so I could pull it all the way up and it still keeps the detail. It has everything there. And so that's one of the reasons why I shoot in both JPEG and RAW, because if I get to a point to where, let me just take this down right quickly and we'll put it back to what it was. If I get to a point to where I want to, do some additional editing that may not be conducive to do it on the JPEG, I can actually go to the RAW file and do it, okay? So with the JPEGs, if I'm going to edit JPEGs, basically what I'm going to do, if I do anything, is I'm going to, if there's like, for instance, I've taken the liberty to actually crop this file. I put it on the rules of thirds. So basically, when you look at this right here, the rules of thirds, the guy walking across the street in the building, they're both on the rules of third. So I've taken the time to do the cropping of that. But outside of that, most people, when they shoot with Fuji, and they shoot JPEG, they basically just, you know, they may do some color enhancements and they basically just transfer it just like it is because it's already been processed. So it's important to get it right in camera. But I want to do a little bit more things in this. I want to bring up some of this. I want to add some shadows into, I want to, you know, add some color into the shadows. I want to add some color into the highlights. I want to bring some of the highlights back. Again, with this file here, if I decide I want to bring out the highlights, I want to bring this back, look what it's doing. It's kind of flattening out the file, right? It's not really recovering highlights. But watch, when I go to the RAW file, I can bring this down like this. And I'm actually, I'm not flattening the file, I'm bringing back those highlights. We're going to fix any lens deficiencies. Now this was shot with the Fujifilm X100V. I love this camera. I love the new lens they put on it. It's just a phenomenal camera. It takes amazing photos, and I mean amazing photos. So let me go ahead and correct this. Now what I've did is taken the liberty to create a preset for that camera or for that lens. So I can go into here and go into where it says camera lens profile. I can just go down and I can actually just select it. And then when I close this back up and go back here, that's one thing I would suggest you do if you have a lens that you use quite frequently and you have to correct it. So all of my corrections have been placed on here. If there's any purple fringing, you could go ahead and do that as well. There is none, but I just do it just in case there is something that I didn't see. So now that lens has been taken care of. If you're shot in something like F16, you might have some diffraction going on, and if that's the case, you would click the diffraction correction and keep it moving in that way. We go back in here. So one of the things I want to do with this is I want to cool this off because it's a little too warm. Now there's a couple ways of doing it, but what I do is I hit the, if I see something that I know that should be pure white, normally you want to go 18% gray. So this pole right here would probably be a better selection than the white, but I'm going to choose the white. I'll show you how they both look. If I go ahead and click on this pole, which is silver, I mean, that cools it off pretty significantly. But let's go ahead. So that drops it to 5132. So let me go ahead and put it back like it was. Now let's choose the crosswalk that has white. That drops it even more, right? So I would choose the 10, choose to select the white point versus something that looks kind of like it's gray, but it's not truly gray. So that's what I wanted to select with that. I can always warm it back up. One of the things that you would want to do when you shoot with Fuji or when you shoot with any camera, one of the rules of it is that if you don't set a custom white balance, one of the things that you can do is just look above you. Just raise your head up and look up. And if you're shooting in daylight that's pretty strong, go ahead and go inside of the white balance with the RAW file and just choose daylight. So you can just do that, and that would have cooled off the photo enough for me not to have to take the dropper and try to select something either pure white or something that is close to 18% gray. So now I got my classic neg look, and now let's go ahead and do this edit real quickly. We're going to pull in some blues and in the highlights. Now I could, if I wanted to try to cool it off, pull some blues in the highlights and just do it in reverse. So let's do that in reverse. If I go into shadows, let's say if I want to warm the shadows up. So we're going to warm those shadows. And then the highlights, because we got so much highlight going on now, we want to cool them off. So this will give me enough color contrast to do that. So we did just the opposite just for this video here. And if I went into the midtones, I can actually go a different route as well. I can pull it towards here, towards the magenta with blue. That's how we're going to go with that. And now what I'll do is I'll go into my black areas. Let's lift that up. We lift up the blacks. We're going to lift up the shadows. All right. And then we're going to take the highlights down. All right. So we got a much more cleaner photo than we had before just by making those color adjustments on the color wheel. And if I go ahead and do a before and after, of course, this is what we started with. And this is what we got right here. Much more cleaner looking photo to do it that way. And then the next thing I would actually do with this is if I wanted to really lighten up other areas, I'm going to take this pointer here on the levels and say, I want this point to be true white at 255. So I take that and point that like this. So now what I've did was move the histogram, because if I put this back, you really want to have information, unless, you know, but you have to go on what visually looks good. Don't just do it because the histogram doesn't have something there. It depends on how your file looks, right? But most people will like to have information in all columns of this histogram. And one way I can do that by pulling it is to say, I want this point right here to be true white. So now the histogram is pulled over and I can really push down the highlights even more, right? And if I want to bring back, you know, and change the black point again, that's going to give me some color contrast or some contrast. I'll do that. And I say that point is now black. You see the histogram move. So now I got this contrasty photo without even moving the contrast slider and without having to go into the curve tool. So one thing I will do with that is for the whites, I can push the whites up, that lightens it up. We're going to push the whites down. So we got more of the color of the building coming back in. And one thing that happened is that we're going to add some vignette. Vignetting was taken off of that lens because of the lens correction we did. Now we're going to put some vignetting back in there. I love vignette, and I think every, so I got about a stop and a quarter of vignette, which is probably too much. We're going to go probably down 3/4 of a stop of vignette. That's close to 3/4. So we have that there. And we have buildings. So if I look into this, this is already sharp. So what I'm going to do is add some clarity, which is going to kind of hype up or boost up the midtones. I'm going to add a little structure there as well. And so we got this razor sharp photo that we got going in. We're doing everything on the base layer. Some people inside of Capture One like to make Capture One resemble Photoshop. And so what I mean by that is they work in Capture One like they do Photoshop. And I purposely do not, because Capture One is not Photoshop and it doesn't pretend to be. And so you're limited in how many layers you're going to have in Capture One, which is up to 16. And there's just some things that Photoshop does a little bit better. So if I need to do that type of editing, I will export this file or send it to Photoshop to be edited. And then, you know, bring it back in Capture One to do some more, the final color grading if I wanted to do that. So I'm going to go and look to sharpening. It already gives you pre-sharpening, but I really like my photo sharpened some more. I'm not going to change the radius. A lot of this you're seeing is because of me using the clarity slider. So I will add some grain, but I'll add fine grain to it. But right there. And that'll give me some of that grain into the photo that I like to resemble some of it. Let's push it up a little bit more to resemble what I had in the JPEG, but not exactly. So we got that, and we have it all on one layer. If I wanted to bring out any more colors, like if I really wanted to pop the blues or pop the reds, I can do that. Right now, this looks pretty good. So if I went back into my color wheel, I can select this dropper, which is going to let me select. If I hold down my Alt key, I can play with the lightness of it, make it darker, or I can make it lighter. Let's make this darker. And then I'll hold down my Shift key, and I'll move up, and that'll saturate it a little bit more. And I can go do the same thing with the reds here. This I want to make darker, and I want to saturate it a little bit more. So we brought out that red. So that looks pretty good. And I could do that with all the colors, but this is already a very colorful photo. And if I wanted to play with some stuff and actually have more shadows come in, but kind of feather off of him, I will create a new layer. And on this new layer, we're going to call it Fading Shadows. And what I'll do with that is I'll go into my tone curve, because if you notice on the bottom of this, there was no need to touch the tone curve. Everything looks pretty good. I could have moved it, but I like what I got out of this here. So I'm going to go back to this one here. And I'm going to go in this area. And if now I could add a dropper. That's probably the easiest way to show you. If I go in this area, so I want to bring that down. I'm going to add a dropper right there, right? And that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to go ahead and hit the P key. So I'll have my loop key. And I'm going to go ahead and pull this all the way down. Just like this. About right there. Now that kind of, if that thrown you off of why would I lighten it to darken it? Well, I'm going to do it a little bit different way. So we got this. We know that it's masked. If I hit M, you can see that's applying to the entire photo. But I'm going to hit L, which is going to bring up my gradient filter. And from the gradient filter, I'm going to pull it like this. And what this is going to allow me to do is basically use it, but it's going to fade off because of the feather that I have on this. So this will kind of fade off. It'll be strong in the corner, but it'll fade off, right? So if I go ahead and take that off, now I got some of that that's fading off. If I take this off, it's extremely light. And I could go ahead and lower the opacity so I can have some of the dark. Let's take it to zero. I'll walk it up to where I say, okay, that's where I want it to be. And we can keep it there, right? And if I wanted to really bring out the highlights in that mirror back here, again, I could go into this here. This is only going to affect just that part, and I can push up those highlights and push up the whites. And you can see if I take that off, those things are different. Put them back on now, there we go. So I'm finished with this photo as far as what I want to do as far as editing this. This is done, and then all I have to do is export it. So that is one of the things that I really, really like about Capture One, is that it's really supporting the Fuji simulations, and the colors that it does in Capture One are different than what you get in Lightroom. I don't want to use the term better, because that is going to be up to someone else's discretion and their likings. But to me, I like what Capture One does with the colors for Fuji better than what Lightroom does with the colors for Fuji. So I hope this has been a help. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. I want to bring you more of this. And if you have a question, or if you have a request for me to do a demonstration inside of Capture One, please send me an email and I will do everything I can to accommodate you. Again, if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe, and thank you for watching.